BBC Audio presents Joyce Grenfell Remembered, The Pursuit of Joy, bringing together five sparkling productions of Joyce Grenfell's work, performed by acting legend Maureen Lipman, alongside a delightful reading by Joyce Grenfell herself of her autobiography.
Hats Off, poems by Joyce Grenfell, read by Maureen Lipman and presented by me, Janie Hampton. Everyone remembers Joyce Grenfell as an entertainer and comedy writer. Many people know that before she went on the stage, she was the first radio critic for the Observer newspaper. Few people know that her very first earnings, at the grand age of 26, were actually as a poet, or versifier, as she preferred to call it. In 1936, her friend Virginia Graham secretly submitted one of these poems to Punch magazine. A few weeks later, Joyce was amazed to receive a cheque for 10 shillings. This success inspired her to write more. From then on, Punch published lots more of her funny, sad, and satirical verse. Here's one from 1937, Monday Morning Mail.
Monday Morning Mail. Darling Mum and darling Dad, how are you? I'm quite all right. Yesterday we won the match. Can I have a flying kite? And I left my skates behind. Could you spare me 1 and 6? Atkinson has got a bike. He can light a fire with sticks. We had treacle tart today. I got E for last week's French. But I wasn't quite the worst. Shall I make a garden bench? It will take a lot of wood, but it's better than a box. Matron says to let you know that I need some woolly socks. Meet you Sunday by the gym. No more news. Love from Tim. Dear Madam, in this morning's news is your ad for General Cook. I am 40, fond of country, 7 years with Colonel Brook. CV and clean in person, honest, sober, fond of dogs. I can manage any oven, ever truly, Emmy Bloggs. Dear neighbour, I'm afraid I must complain once more about the noise your lovebirds make every morning at 4:30. And perhaps I'm not offending when I mention gramophones. Don't you think that yours wants mending? Anticipating peace, Jane Jones. Cocktail stuck, Friday at 7. Bimbo's flat, it will be heaven.
Over the past 2 years, I've been writing the first biography of Joyce Grenfell. To my surprise, poems by her started appearing all over the place, in among her papers, in loose press cuttings, with letters, and in notebooks. Many of these had never been published. I found the next one in a basement. It was written in an exercise book, with illustrations by Joyce around the edge.
Hats. Never wear a pixie hood if your face is long and good. And beware the boyish berry when you're merely mild, not merry. Do not sport an eastern turban if you're simple and suburban. Best not risk the veiled toque if you are inclined to smoke. Shun the all-revealing bonnet when your face has spots upon it. Don't drown neath the Cossack cap if yours is a midget map. Lastly, leave the sailor hat if you look like this. Or that.
Sometimes I didn't find the actual poem, but references to them in letters. I've got one in Punch this week, or have you seen my poem in the Observer? So I went to look for more in the Bodleian Library in Oxford. I discovered that old copies of Punch are bound into very large volumes, so I'd have to go down into the bowels of the library to look at them. I was put into a tiny lift and sent 2 or maybe 3 stories below ground, under the streets of central Oxford. Then I was led down miles of dark passages of bookcases and eventually arrived at 6-inch-thick, leather-bound volumes of Punch, going right back to 1841. There I was abandoned with the words, "Just make sure you get out by 5." I searched through the issues of the 1930s and 40s, gradually identifying Joyce's poems, copying them all out by hand in pencil, as the ancient rules insisted. Joyce's early poems describe the time when fields were ploughed by horses, trains ran on time, and the family cook was paid £50 a year. The upper-class world in which she grew up in the 1920s included finishing school in Paris and being presented at Buckingham Palace as a debutante. 10 years later, she wrote Farewell to Fun.
I was finished off in Munich and I had a week in Rome, on my way from gay Vienna via Florence to my home. I'm really quite sophisticated, and I think you will agree that I've got the polished glamour of a girl of 23. Oh dear, it won't be easy to become a child once more, but I've got to be a debutante. It's such a frightful bore. I'm 17 next Wednesday week, and on that fateful day, my fond mamma will give a ball to start me on my way. I've got a dozen party frocks in which to play the part. All of them are white, of course, and none of them are smart. So I have to give up lipstick and red varnish on my nails, do without my cigarettes and brown Bavarian ales. Oh, how shall I answer when mere infants in the guards ask what pack I hunt with, or do I play at cards? Will I join a jolly crowd at Eton on the 4th, and will the 12th of August find me heading for the north? Oh, for those discussions with Hans and Franz and Paul on life and love and music, and should we marry at all? So say goodbye to Munich. Vienna days are gone. Forget the fun in Florence, for work has now begun. Bringing up father. Do we have to go to the mildewy meadows, who live in a house which the Albert Hall shadows? They will play very deep intellectual games and drop some distinguished foreigners' names. It wouldn't insult them, for they'll never know, so I really don't see why we bother to go. Let's sup by our fireside instead, my dear. Let's sup by our fireside instead. My love, we must go to the mildewy meadows, who live in a house which the Albert Hall shadows. They are giving a dance for their daughter in June, and remember, our Millicent's coming out soon. So we've got to be nice, and you mustn't be silly, to people who might send an invite to Millie. Leave your fireside, you must, my pet. Leave your fireside, you must. Now why did we go to the mildewy meadows, who live in a house which the Albert Hall shadows? I spoke to a duchess whose eyesight had gone. She took me for Geoffrey, her dead sister's son. Our hostess mistook me for old Colonel Slaughter. Is this how I'm helping to launch our dear daughter? I won't leave my fireside again. Oh, no, I won't leave my fireside again. Fetch down the album. When I get uppish, there's only one cure to banish my posing and pride. Fetch down the album, it's certain and sure, quite soon to have dealt with my side. Look at the naked child flat on the rug, rolling its marble eyes, shining and smug. First little footsteps at Salcombe-on-Sea. Don't look away, that baby is me. Look at that creature with wires in her teeth. Those were the days when I learned to say please. Look at the chicken wings moored to my hat. How could my mother have dressed me in that? Look at this cloche worn low to the lips. Is it a wonder I never launched ships? Ah, that's done the trick. I'm quite humble once more. All of my uppishness fled. Don't try to squash me when next I get cocky. Just fetch down the album instead. Sad plight of the stout. I wish I were a handful, a pocket full of fun, the pixie type, the fairy type, a laughing in the sun. I wish I were a tinkerbell to storm the heart of man, a wondrous never-never girl, a female Peter Pan. I'd love to be a plaything, an elfin, childish lass, instead of which I fear I am the large heroic class.
During the 1930s, Joyce and her husband Reggie lived in a cottage on Clifden Estate, owned by her millionaire aunt, the MP Nancy Astor. Some of Joyce's poems may seem rather old-fashioned and unpolitically correct. But remember, they are old-fashioned. They were written two generations ago in a very different world.
Cri de cœur. Blessed Monday morning when the house is mine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.